How are the treats going round? Are they circulating? Yes, they are. I think, yes, we should all have some by the time Poppy starts talking. Anything else I need to talk about? Well, before we start, of course, I'd like to thank Imperial College for providing this building and welcoming us to Kensington, the heart of Athenium. And yes, thank you very much to Imperial College and to Patrick Naylor for arranging our venue here tonight. So all that remains is for me to introduce Poppy Crum, who has very kindly agreed to speak to us tonight. Dr. Poppy is a senior scientist at Dolby Labs and is also a visiting professor at CCRMA.
Stanford. Consulting professor at Stanford.
Consulting professor, okay. Wow. Very impressive CV. And my PhD was in psychoacoustics and I studied approximately the line of inquiry that you did until about 8 years ago. So if you ever get bored of that job, I'll quite happily have it, thanks. But to talk to us about technology and stretching sensory savvy and neural plasticity and all kinds of wonderful sensory things is Poppy. So thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. It's great to be here. We're going to have the lecture tonight is going to take a few different turns. The beginning is going to be sort of heavily weighted on illusions and thinking about them, and the second part is going to think about how we can stretch our brains in different ways. Now, I handed out a pill beforehand, and remember, I didn't actually hand that out. Wait, you found them outside. But what I promise, this is considered an additive as it's classified in the United States. It's miraculin. It comes from what's called a miracle berry. Who has heard of a miracle berry before? Very few people? No? Okay, so a miracle berry is actually native to West Africa. What it does is it binds to your taste receptors, specifically to receptors for sweet, okay? And it limits them from activating when at a neutral pH level, and instead it sort of amplifies in the face of acid, okay? So you can start to think about what's actually going to happen, okay? So sort of a theme of the way we want to think tonight, and this should be entertaining and fun at some level. Hopefully we'll revisit a lot of illusions and things you've come in contact before, but it's about how susceptible and malleable and ever-changing our sensory world is. And really, by the end of tonight, you know, let's be in the mindset of how we can think about manipulating our senses, what the future for sensory augmentation should look like, or where there are big open areas for study and research and technology advancements, and how we might maximize that. So, what I want you to do right now, at the beginning, I'll join you once you've all raised your. I want those of you who are taking the pill, I want you to put it in your mouth and let it dissolve. Okay, you can move it around your mouth. You want it to coat your mouth. Okay, you don't want to bite it. You don't want to swallow it. Okay, this is not a. For some people, this is a very intense experience. For some, it's a little bit different.
But you have two ones.
And, okay. Yes, so go ahead and put it in your mouth and just suck on it, let it dissolve, and swish it around, let it coat your tongue. It's not going to, again, it's where we're going to go when you're ready, when you've finished, when yours is dissolved, raise your hand, okay? It'll be in the middle of my lecture, or when I'm talking, so just do this. And then what I want you to do is take a bite of your lemon or your lime, and whatever you have. We have some more if you want to try a different piece of fruit, too, if you only got one or the other. And this is... We'll talk about it more when everybody gets there, okay? All right. This is a very simple picture, and it's one of my favorites. So who knows what this is? This is a Necker cube. It's a cube, but it's a particularly interesting one. So a Necker cube is a bistable perception, meaning you can see it in two different ways, and it sort of waffles between the two. Depending on many different features, we can be biased to see in one way or another. Now, why do I like this? Well, in this case, the projection orientation of that bar is causing you to see it in one way or another. When the blue-red bar comes through, I see the face pointing down and to the left. When the red bar goes up, I see the front face pointing up and to the right. Yes, red bar, I see it down and to the left. Blue, I see it up and to the right. Do you see it switch? You can go back and forth. Why is this interesting? In cognitive science, people find this a very interesting problem. Computer science, they find it an interesting problem because it's such a simple figure, but it's the role of context. Whatever the context is completely manipulates how I experience the world in this very simple condition. But we can extrapolate that to so many different areas, and that's sort of the common theme of understanding how malleable perception is to everything we introduce into our environment or our expectations. So, our context, our expectations, yes, absolutely. Oh, you're done. All right. Okay, so once you are finished, what you can do is bite into your fruit. And what you should notice is, again, this is at the idea of what we experience today and what we experience, how one stimulus, one simple stimulus can completely change our sensory experience of something that we have even a very long history with, a long expectation that we've built up long prior. Okay, so go ahead, and I'm curious if you find it interesting. Is it sweet for you? Okay, good. Very good. All right, so a simple figure, one where we control our world. And an illusion that I want to start with, everyone, how many people are familiar with the McGurk effect? Okay, good. This is always an illusion that I think is important to come back to. So let's start with when you're watching, I want everyone to watch his lips carefully and tell me what you hear, okay? I'm going to play it a couple of times.
Ba, ba, ba. Ba, ba, ba. Ba, ba, ba.
What did you experience?
Well, it sounded like ba, 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 but he wasn't plumbing his lips. His lips were da, da, da.
Did you hear ba, ba, ba?
Only when I closed my eyes.
Oh, you're not supposed to close your eyes, but what did you... I asked you, you have to play along, right? No. You heard it, ta, ta, ta. So interesting, and now I want you to watch it again, and this time, of course, you may close your eyes, and you may open your eyes as well. You can modulate between open and closed eyes.
Ba, 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 ba.
Okay, so did it change? Did you? When you close your eyes, everyone should hear ba, ba. Okay, consistency. And when you open your eyes and you focus on his lips, what you hear is probably like a ta or a ta. And, in the classic illusion, people hear da, da, da. Now, why is this? This is a particularly interesting illusion, and it's one that I think is key to the way we should always think about our world, because what's actually happening is he's saying ba, 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 okay? He's actually mouthing ga, 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 okay? Now, you may see a different version in the da, so he's mouthing ga, ga, ga. Your brain is receiving conflicting information, okay? It's completely incongruous, and what does it do? It gives you an answer that's entirely illusory. Okay, it's not getting what we see right, it's not getting what we hear right, it's giving us something in between. That in between is based on our experience of the world, it's based on our expectations, it's based on our priors of what we have been exposed to in terms of our vocal, our visual speech, and our semantic alphabet that we've built up in from since we were very young. Some languages that don't have the same exemplars as you will not experience the McGurk effect in the same way. Okay, it's very much an individual experience. Now, the way he presents it, watch it one more time. Sorry. If you watch a different version, you might hear da, da, da even stronger. It has to do with subtleties in the visual speech that let your brain experience it more as ta, ta, ta. Okay. Now, why are illusions so scientifically interesting? And why are they interesting from a technological point? Why do we care about them at Dolby? Or why do I care about them as a scientist? Well, illusions tell us where the brain is malleable, Okay, it tells us where the brain is making allowance, where the brain is getting it wrong. Okay, our brain's evolved to make decisions, to take input, to assess sensory input needs. But at the same time, if we assess the stimulus entirely as it is, we're not very efficient. So the brain has to be robust. And illusions show us where the brain makes those mistakes, and it gives us on a technological side. It gives us insight where we can probe, where we can build, where we have the capacity to develop experiences and how we can manipulate them. By understanding the illusion and being able to manipulate the illusion, that gives us, that opens up our world. So a common theme of today's talk, there are sort of three different areas that I want to focus on. And they all are sort of where I think a lot of study and technological development is ripe for. So the first is maximizing our perceptual control. You know, the capacity of technology in terms of computing capacity is there. What we need now, more information, the ability to process more information isn't better. What we need to know is what is the right information. We want to be, the brain doesn't process everything, the brain throws information away. We need to know what that is. We need to be building robust computational models of sensory experience. It comes back to perception, psychophysics, but how do we model that? How do we create it? How do we understand how our senses combine, how cues combine for a single sense to understand the different perceptual situations? That's the first. The second, then, is how do we exploit and train targeted neural circuits? We can build technology, but hopefully what we'll understand by the end of, or we already do, and we're just going to talk about more today, is the idea that I can give whatever comes into our brain, whether it's you, me, we all have a different experience of that. So we have, now we can have the same piece of technology, but we want to have control over our biological system. We want to have control over how we experience that technology, how we work with it, how we make the most of it, how we make the richest experience of our world going forward. And so that's what I call sort of exploiting and training targeted neural circuits, and really thinking about how plastic the brain is and how your experience and my experience can be very different, but it has to do with my expertise. Or when I say expertise, I mean my exposure. And finally, then how do we use that to really build technologies that we can work into? What do those look like? And I'm not really going to talk about that so much tonight, but I think hopefully maybe that's something we can brainstorm with in questions at the end. All right, so let me just... I'm just going to... A couple of times tonight, I'm going to have to pull out and go to... A few. All right. Now, this is an illusion I really like. It's out of Harvard, and this has to do with cue combination and how we integrate information. I'm going to watch a couple, but I want you all to focus, and you have to play along. If you don't play along, I'm not going to be able to know what your experience is. But first, I want you to focus on this dot. Okay? So just focus on the dot very carefully. Okay, so what did you see? How many people did you saw?
There was a strong thing in the middle.
So you saw you saw local change, and then when it started rotating, did you still see that local change? Or did it seem to, watch it again, and this time?
It trickled around, and then it just, the whole thing went.
And when it, then they.
Like the whole image.
Exactly, now I want you to watch. Focus on a local position instead of the global change. And so what do you see when you modulate where your attention is focused?
You still change color?
Exactly. The local change has not changed, is still as frequent as it was, as it is. So watch it one more time, and you can modulate from focusing on the dot to looking at the local. But you'll see that, and I'm going to show you one more. I really like this illusion. In fact, we can take it even further. We go on a roller coaster ride. I like this too. Wait, let's put us in full screen mode. There we go. We'll go back. I guess that's kind of low resolution, but it should still work. So we're going to go on the roller coaster ride. You can imagine this. I find this really interesting because, so what's happening is, there's an inverse correlation with how fast I'm moving and my ability to detect the local change, right? So we can watch it one more time while I talk about it, but it's true in both situations. I like this because it's a visual example, but it's really sort of, you know, the idea behind like a compression algorithm. What do we want? We need to pay attention to what we, you know, if we spend all our time trying to encode every bit of this change, we're really wasting our energy, right? Because in fact, we have to understand how our perception of this one feature, which is color change, is how it's dependent on the speed, the motion, the proximity to where I'm focused. There are all these different parameters that come into play if I want to build some computational model. And then I know where I really need to throw my computational power. And I want it to be, it will allow me to have a better experience because I'm trying to model something very differently. Now, say I'm a fighter pilot, right? If I'm a fighter pilot, this is something I want to know because I know that I'm not as sensitive as I should be to different areas. So maybe I want to train my brain to behave differently. Or I need to be aware of it because I need to have control over the space. I need to have control over where my brain is naturally is throwing away information if I want to. Got it? All right. So let me bug out. So I will bounce back in slideshow from current slide. Apologies. Similarly, so our expectations. So I've shown you, you just experienced how context can change. And having the miraculin showed you how even your expectations, you have strong priors and your physiological system is, you know, we just compromised or we went against your biological expectation. And in this case, this isn't just, we have expectations of something as simple as like how lines recede in the distance, right? And that tells us that things when lines are receding and we see the same size object or same size image on our retina, our brain interprets that as for there to be receding lines and something to produce the same image on our retina, it must be larger, it must be bigger, right? I can promise you it's not. So those monsters might be, but we can create that. Similarly, I love examples of expectation just because, you know, these are things that, you know, Hollywood or artists, they understand all of these principles. They understand them, they can manipulate them in the same way Bach understood auditory scene analysis in the most beautiful and complex way. But then it's different to then be the scientists that have to describe it and be able to quantify it to build tools that can actually interface with the creative side or with the artist. So here's an example. How many people know this illusion by Adelson? Okay, well, okay. If I tell you how many people think A and B are the same luminance, are producing the same hue? Yes? I would hope you would say no, unless you're trying to trick me. But here we have an oscillating grid and we have a cylinder. I had one of my interns from Stanford actually built a 3D model of this that was really beautiful and recreated the illusion and so he could move it around. But if I take away context and I take away your expectation of what happens when a shadow is cast, things change. So all I've done here is put a screen. And now if I ask you if A and B are the same luminance, how many people are going to tell me that they are? Okay, good. Right answer. But what's nice is, again, I have control over your world. I may be the one here, but I can change the opacity of this mask. And if we do that, you can slowly see the illusion arise again. Right? So we go back, and we can go back and forth. So what is this? What's happening? If we remove the cylinder, so we have a couple of things working together. We have, you know, we know this is an oscillating grid. So we have, that creates an expectation on its own. But the real issue is that here's this cylinder, and we know a cylinder is casting a shadow. And we are very, our brain is very adept at paying attention to when a shadow is cast or should be cast. If it's producing the same luminance to my eye and there should be a shadow, then we interpret that as it must be it must have originated as a lighter hue, a lighter luminance in this case. And if you look around you, this is happening in how we see how you see shadows cast throughout the space. Now, you can imagine an artist has to be have a very intuitive sense about how this works, but then being able to create the computational model that allows you to manipulate it or build the tools that works with it is a different story. So, sorry, these are... At the core of this is a very simple idea, which is that, you know, our perception, you cannot just model the stimulus. You can't get every bit correct and assume that you know what's going to be experienced. And you should never assume that because you've created the same sound or same image and that person A is hearing it or seeing it, that person B is also having the same experience. That's not true. And so you have to be thinking about you can do your best. It's a good starting point to have that control. But then next comes, well, what's happening? And we're going to talk a lot about individual differences or like plasticity and how what that really does to the experience. But I like to look at this as, you know, if you consider, sorry, this was my company, like somebody did this. This is a sound. So singing penguins equals sound. This equals peripheral processing, and this equals everything else above. But if we start, you know, if we consider the old view, something more like this, where it was really about capturing and providing an exact replication of what the stimulus was, and that should tell you what your answer is going to be, I think we absolutely know that this is more the perspective that we need to be taking. Just thinking about understanding, not just modeling the system up to the auditory nerve. If you look at, you know, codex, most of the auditory codex that exist, I consider, MP3, DD, Dolby Digital, any of the codecs that exist, they're a computational model of the brain. A very simple one, but they are. They're trying to model psychophysics, perception, but they stop at the auditory nerve. So they stop here, okay? Peripheral processing being the cochlea up to the auditory nerve, but then all the transformations that happen from the auditory nerve up through the cortex, and we're going to be talking mostly about the cortex tonight, all of that is very little computational modeling has taken place to gather in the information that exists. Machine learning aspects, there's a lot of information happening in the neuroscience world that can begin to be integrated into the technological space. And the processing capacity is there. So now I'm going to just exit really quick. Sorry. All right. So two ways that information combines that I said at the beginning I want to talk about are both, we have cross-modal integration. Our senses are constantly interacting, much as we experienced in the McGurk effect. They're also constantly interacting within a single modality. And we'll talk about how cue combinations. So we had an example of how our motion and visual color change were interacting and creating a cue integration, illusory experience, okay? McGurk effect, it was auditory and visual based on our expectations of what we see and what we hear. What's a really common auditory visual illusion that we experience every day? Ventriloquism. Okay. We all live in a state of ventriloquism. You should be well aware of that. Okay. So if you think about while ventriloquism is behind why we can enjoy the cinema, it's also, I will one of the plasticity examples I'll give you at the end of the lecture is related to this. But if you think about what your brain, everyone close your eyes and try to localize where I am when I'm talking, okay? So if you think about where I'm walking, I'm coming through the speakers. Obviously, that's probably going to mess everything up right now. But I think about myself. I'm an object. I'm a poppy object. I have multiple sensory cues that I'm giving to your brain. I'm creating an image on your retina. I'm producing ITDs and ILDs and spectral cues that tell you approximately where I am in space. Okay. I'm also have a smell. Hopefully not too much, but I've been on an airplane a long time. And I also have, you know, a touch sensation. All of these can integrate. There are certain pathological conditions that exist that actually have trouble integrating information from the same, from multiple senses to create an object. And it makes it very hard to be efficient in the world and to actually get around. But if we think about just something as simple as where I am in space and what I see and what I hear, why does ventriloquism work in the sort of the throwing, nobody's throwing their voice. It's purely an illusory experience that's based on our brain's assessment of variability between the different modalities, okay? Why can I, and this is behind why we can enjoy the movies as well. When I move my hand, and if I had a dummy doll here, I'm creating a situation where, what I see, if I had to assess where an object is, me, the accuracy from my visual system is much better, much less variability. If I have to assess where I am based solely on my auditory system, there's more variability, okay? And so the system, our brain is very good at this. It's the most popular way, one of the most popular ways to consider this is through like Bayesian modeling and thinking about the error that each system is producing and how the brain is constantly changing between the two, but it's based on our priors. It's based on our expectations that come into that system. Okay, you can manipulate it. You can manipulate the error in the visual system, and then suddenly the auditory system becomes more dominant. It's not just that the visual system wins. It happens to have less error in knowing where something is, and that's why ventriloquism or why, spatial location is so dependent on the visual system. Well, the auditory system, in many ways, is more accurate in a different way. It's faster from a physiological standpoint than the visual system. So how is it more accurate? How would you guess the auditory system is more accurate? Temporally. So knowing when something is in time, the auditory system can often drive your illusory experience or drive the visual system. So in all of these cases, what you're actually experiencing, when I walk down the street and I hear a sound and I try to localize it, I'm actually experiencing an illusion. My visual system is probably pulling my auditory system to where I actually locate the sound, and often knowing where something is happening. I don't know if you've ever been driving down the road and you see lights flashing and you're listening to music. It's very common to think that those lights flashing are like with the beat of the music you're listening to, right? Even though there's probably a lot of error. But it's very easy to assimilate that. So here's an example where the auditory system, and I don't know if all of you will experience this. This is a nice example by Shands, a professor at Caltech, Lewis Sykes, who is actually, I think, in Manchester, has done a nice job of making a little demo of it, but we'll try it because it's an example where the auditory system creates an illusory visual experience. And some people experience it, some people don't. Focus on the dot, and I want you to tell me what you're going to see is you're going to see, if you focus on the little dot, you're going to hear sounds, you're going to hear beeps, and then there will be a flashing of a circle, and it's how many times you see the circle. I think you'll catch. So, So did you get the idea? It's it's a subtle illusion, but what your auditory system, because your auditory system is more accurate, and also because you're looking, if you're looking at the dot, not at the big dot, your visual system is not in your fovea, it's in your periphery. So it means there's more ambiguity. So again, if you think about it sort of as a Bayesian model, and you're trying to create, when there's more ambiguity, your sensory system is going to rely on the sense that's providing it more information. And so people often experience that the visual dot has flashed more than it has, or less than it has. They experience that the visual dot flashed as many times as they heard the sound. So you can create an illusory experience of the flash.
So weren't they all actually double flashes?
Yeah, mostly.
Can you run it again?
Yeah.
Now we'll look at the circle again.
Sometimes it flashes. It's actually mixing between 1, 2, and 3. But you do experience it incorrectly when you look. Some are more powerful than others, for sure. All right. Oh, shucks. That's not what I meant to do. Ah! Okay. One moment. All right. So there are three concepts that I think are very important I've got a little bit to go, so I need to go a little faster, but there's a neural receptive field, cortical magnification, and topography. So we're talking about how our senses interact. When our senses interact, I might call that rapidly induced plasticity, because our model of the world is having to change quickly. But then if we think about some of the things we're going to talk about in the next period of time, I actually need to go quite fast, I realized. Do I need to finish right at 8? I may finish a few minutes after 8. Is that okay? That's okay?
Yeah, all right. Until 9.
So. Oh, okay. Well, that's fine. I just want to keep you. If you get tired, you may leave, please. But neuroreceptive field, cortical magnification, and topography are both very important. Are all three important? Are those terms that are very familiar in this room, or are they new?
No.
Okay. Very good. So a neural receptive field is the idea that every cell in my brain has a certain set of stimuli that it will optimally respond to. Okay? It may respond to different stimuli, and I'll give you some examples of what that would be. But in our visual system, there are cells that Hubel and Wiesel won the Nobel Prize for identifying that we had cells in our visual system that optimally responded to certain orientations, okay, of contours. And that helps us identify objects in the visual, in the boundaries of objects in the visual space. In our auditory system, we have cells that optimally respond to certain frequencies. And then within that set, you'll have a cell that cares about a particular frequency that it responds, it will fire the most to at the lowest sound level, okay? And then you have cells that optimally respond to both what we see and what we hear. And that's an example of what I want to show you. So we've talked about sensory integration. This is some work by John Driver, and I like it because it gets it. This is just an image, but each of these, it's highlighting the fact that each cell in your brain, we're going to be talking about the auditory system quite a bit, but it's not always just that a cell cares about what it hears or what it sees. And in fact, these are, if we look at just the blue areas, these are cells whose receptive fields optimally responded only when it had auditory and visual information, okay? So if I look at, if I were recording just the cell and displaying to the system being, a human or an animal, images or sounds, this is the response to just the visual This is a response to just the auditory, and this is a response to both auditory and visual, and it's really synergistic. It's a example of 1 + 1 really does equal 4. Okay, it's like the system cares about having multiple sensory information, and that's how we have to be thinking more and more as we build technologies. We've really isolated ourselves at being auditory or visual, but that's not how our brains work. In fact, trimodal areas, these areas that he identified really care about auditory, visual, and haptic information. I mean, I've spent a lot of time recording single cells in primate brains, and it's very common you will find cells that have to be driven by multiple senses to be able to elicit responses. So I'm going to come back to plasticity, but first, thinking about cue combination, I wanted to take you through an example of how within just the auditory system, a problem of perceptual, maximizing perceptual control that I've thought about a lot. So that's the first thing we're going to do. Then we're going to think about, then how do we move forward to think about plasticity and how we can integrate plasticity. So phonemic restoration is a particularly interesting example. I spent many years of my life very interested in understanding something as simple as when I listen to an old record and there are scratches on that record, I still experience music. It still sounds like music, right? And we may be audiophiles, we may like to hear things that are very pristine in how they sound, but you can't get around that you still hear music. You don't hear cut up segments. And everywhere there's a scratch, there's just missing information. Right, and the same thing happens to us when we wander around the world and someone coughs or a car goes by. Every time there's energetic masking, it's obliterating to our brains the fine detail of what was actually there, and yet our brain fills this in. So,
the state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city. The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
So how many people, what did you hear? Okay. So now I want you to listen to this. We're going to listen one more time. And I want you to focus on the word legislatures, okay? And you heard a cough, correct? Did everyone hear a cough in the last one? Now I'm going to play what is actually there if I take away the cough.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Okay.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Okay. So did anyone hear the S? No. Now, I'm just adding the cough back.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city. The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
All right. So I grew up in Iowa, and this was a familiar sight where when I was young, your brain tries to solve problems in the best way it can. It does it in the simplest, probabilistically most expected way. So you have your priors. And before I had developed enough, I thought cows were very long. When in fact, that's the more probable experience. And we know that our ear is having to solve the problem of receiving a mess of sound waves and orienting which belong to which particular sound or which object. So it's very easy for it to get it wrong. It's also very easy for it to solve problems for us in fantastical ways. In this case, what you heard in phonemic restoration, that cough is acting as a broad spectral stimulus, and it's filling in that information in the best way it can. Okay, so it's taking that information and essentially acting as a cookie cutter so that it gives you what it provides you a signal. So we're having to resolve, if this is the cough and this is the speech, your brain's having to resolve something dynamically in space often, in time, in spectrum, in level. It's really a complicated problem, and it does it extremely well based on both. I spent a lot of time looking at how our brains extrapolate the velocity of what's come before, and also how we make sense of the probabilistic expectations of the semantic context of where something appears. One of the things that you can take an example like this, understanding perception in psychophysics, and then take it to another level. So I've spent more time in my life as a physiologist than as a psychophysicist. Most of my life has been recording cells in the primate brain. I focused on the auditory cortex, and I focused specifically on areas, differentiating areas in their degree of, so this is primary auditory cortex, and the degree of complexity away from auditory cortex, and also identifying the laminar location and the, basically treating individual cells as a circuit in the brain. So that, you know, in the same way you might model an electrical engineering circuit, you can do the same thing with an anatomical and a physiological functional circuit in the cortex. but if we go and we think about perceptually something as simple as what we just heard, phonemic restoration, what's happening in the brain in that case? So here, I just want to, this is really quickly, I want to give you an idea of what you might see. So here, if I'm playing just a sound, each one of these is a different sound. Okay, I'm just representing, this is a group of stimuli. So this is like, chweep, 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 okay? And I'm going to play each one of those, and I'm going to record the neural response of the cell. Okay, and you can see this cell, this is all background, this is sort of the spontaneous rate of the cell. And so it responds to noise, and then it kind of cares about the FM sweep because it cares about, you know, sound. So as it's going, the cell's going, okay? Now, I'm going to do something interesting. Now I'm going to align a sweep. So if the cell, I told you certain cells like a particular frequency, this cell responded maximally to this frequency, and I aligned a sweep such that if it disappeared behind a noise, it would create a continuous velocity through that noise burst. And what was really nice is then you see, so here, now we're going with a noise burst in between, much like the cough, okay, but simplified. And this is what happens to the receptive field. So this is responding to that sweep. And then here's the receptive field that was here before. So this cell was very liberal in what it responded to. Now suddenly I've given it something to listen for, and it's within this context, it's become very selective in what it cares about. Okay, it's become very selective in what it responds to, and you can see it get very narrow in the set of stimuli that it's responding to. So it's contextually modifying. This is a single cell in your brain, okay? Contextually modifying what it's responding to in terms of a stimulus that we all experience very differently, and we know that this is creating a different experience. Okay? So contextually depending narrowing of a receptive field, it's changing its selectivity. This sort of thing happens in your brain all the time. So you have to be thinking about how everything is modifying. This is essentially what it's not plasticity, but it's a rapidly induced change in the selectivity of what you might be experiencing. And, you know, could be tensionally drawn shift. Similarly, let's see, I'm going to just sort of skip over this very quickly, but the idea of ways that we can, within a single modality, really think about creating a richer experience. This is, I think many of you have heard about object-based coding over, you know, using metadata to identify the location of objects in the scene. I think you'll hear more about that in, you know, in the near future, but some of the beauty of an object-based audio rendering is it really allows a better integration with your visual system, with manipulation of your perceptual system. It gives you it gives you freedoms that channel-based systems don't always provide. You can do some things if you have a lot of speakers, but it, really what you're trying to target with an object-based system is tapping into the sensory system and giving yourself the flexibility and capability of working, of manipulating your senses in a more natural way. So I think, I'm not going to talk too much about this, but it's a very exciting possibilities. So we've talked a little bit about contextually modifying a single modality. The key thing that it really comes down to in the future, I think, is understanding plasticity and how plastic our brains are, and understanding the control and capabilities we can have as developers and just as humans that experience the world. Cortical plasticity is particularly interesting for tonight. It's what I'm going to talk about. It doesn't mean that plasticity doesn't happen at other stages of your physiological system, because it does. Cortical plasticity just happens to be where cells tend to be more malleable, and where a lot of research has been focused. okay? The lower down in your system, you will find tends to be less malleable, more hardwired. And also you'll find certain systems, like certain species, where you don't have the malleability and flexibility that one system may have to another. And I'll give you an example of that, okay? I want you to think about, before I talk about it, what's the difference between a species that can move its eyes in their sockets and one that can't? Okay? Does that create a problem for how I orient my experience of what I see and what I hear? It's very different, right? And you can imagine that that kind of registration and integration is very complex for, say, a mammal that can move its eyes and an owl that can't. So, back to our neural receptive field, cortical magnification. Cortical magnification, so three, if there are three things we talk about, cells in your system, in your brain, they care about certain sets, optimally care about certain sets of stimuli. Those stimuli may belong to particular features of what you, of hearing, sight, sound, or touch. They also may care about multiple senses, integrating information from a multiple sense. Cortical magnification is the idea that if something's, the more experience you have with something or the more relevant something is to your system, you're going to have usually more cells devoted to that. You will often find increased sensitivity. Okay, I'll show you some, I will show you some examples of this. But cortical magnification specifically means sort of more cells and usually more area of your brain. Okay. How many people have heard that before? So I'm a violinist, and if you look in, I'll show you, here's an, how many people have seen this guy? Okay, this is a homunculus, and I actually was looking for the, this is based on a rendering of Penfield's, this is the sensory homunculus, okay? It's a very, this is an odd looking creature. It's actually a rendering of Penfield's sensory homunculus that is in the London Museum of Natural History. There's a statue of him. But this is really just a data representation. That's all it is, okay? It is simply a data representation of sort of the sensitivity and cortical magnification of your somatosensory cord, of an average, normal, let's see, exemplar human somatosensory cortex. Okay? This is recording in the brain.
Yes, but which senses?
Oh.
Is it the combination of all of the touch-oriented senses?
Just sensitivity, just touch. Not just pressure.
So not heat.
Not heat. Nothing. No. Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
So that's just the division between the parietal and the frontal cortexes.
Correct.
Line round.
Yep.
So the visual cortex and other things are not
included. No, this is just a somatosensory cortex, okay? Now, so this is a 3D representation of, this is sort of what Penfield diagrammed years ago. Well, what do you see? So you see areas where you don't have fine sensitivity, or have much less representation comparatively to places where you have increased sensitivity. Okay. One thing I do with my students always is I ask them to describe their homunculus to me. Okay? Because this is one way that we're all very different. If I'm, you know, I'm a violinist, like what would I predict? Or what do I I'm positive is true. So my right hand, my right hemisphere representation of my left hand, so it'll be contralateral, would be much larger, my fingers will be much bigger than say my right hand. So my left hand representation will be given much more area of my cortex and many more cells devoted to the dexterity and sensitivity that I need to have in my left hand in compared to my bow arm, right? If you look at a homunculus of, say, myself or one of my 20-year-old students at Stanford, what would I expect to see? What's one thing that's definitely changed? Well, I'd expect them to see really big thumbs. They spend all their time texting, right? These guys, they grew up that way in very critical periods. So, you know, the homunculus of the modern-day mobile phone user is very different than the homunculus of a different era.
I think it's changed since the iPhone era. Now you've got a real keyboard.
Yeah, that's true. But the dexterity necessary is very acute. Trumpet player, an embouchure, the sensitivities that someone who's, or a vocalist, right? The sensitivities that you have, what I like to call your sort of superpowers, what you've spent your time developing, these show up in differently in the data representation of your homunculus and what your brain looks like, okay? But you can constantly think about that, and you should, because the individual sitting next to you has a very different baseline than you do.
How is that generated? Is that a prediction or somebody's idea, or was there actually measurement involved in?
This was actually measurements from Penfield. So, but Penfield did a lot of cortical recordings, of human cortical recordings, many years ago. Then this would be a data representation based on that. I believe.
Of an average.
Correct. Yeah.
Right. Not a specific person.
Averaged across people. Correct. Right. And then you can look at human, imaging, fMRI, PET, different types of human imaging, and you'll find different representations. I'm going to show you plasticity. I'm going to show you this is something I want to talk about in different species. So lastly, the other word that's up there, so that's cortical magnification and topography. We're going to talk about examples of that. But topography is the idea that different areas actually are represented in strategic, I call them strategic brains, let's call them evolutionarily strategic, because our brains would be as big as a bathtub if we didn't actually have things that, cells that need to interact together, close together. In the auditory system, you find topography, what's called tonotopic organization, meaning that as I go, the different cells higher in frequency are next to cells they're slightly lower or slightly higher. You find maps of frequency throughout your auditory pathway that represent your cochlea representation. Okay, that's just preserved in all sorts of maps, as all through the cortex. Similarly, in the visual system, you find maps of your retinal space that show up. And then you can actually have, for the visual system, you can imagine you need to have contrast effects for boundaries and things you need to allow cells to interact that are representing nearby areas. So we like to look at topography. So this is just an example of low to high frequencies, and I'll show you some more examples. Now, as we go to the cortex, I want to give you. Don't worry, we're doing good on time now. But when you get to the cortex, your brain is very plastic. So I want to give you sort of a whole bunch of multiple examples of ways the brain can be changed based on sort of pressure, needs pressure of the system, or simply changes in the input of what the system is receiving. So this is an example of sort of an amputee. And when what you have is dominant hand, intact hand, okay? So what you would expect to see, So with an amputee, you show, you're seeing, this is what you should see, okay, with the dominant hand. But in fact, when you lose the input from one arm, you're actually seeing more representation in the brain, because what this is drawing, the importance is, it's key to have inhibition, okay? The system has to have inhibition. It's not just excitation. And so here you're getting a reorganization of the brain that's happening with loss of input, okay? I'll give you multiple examples. Here's an example where each of these areas they've mapped out in the cortex of this is a monkey, a primate, okay? And they each correspond to a different area. This is a paper from Michael Merzen. They each correspond to a different area on the hand, okay? Now, what they've done is they've actually reared this animal such that they could only use certain fingers and they couldn't use other fingers. but what it, so they have certain digits that they have to use to be able to use tools to eat, and so they become very key to their development. And what you see is you see in these distal segments, the ones with the stars, you see these are receptive fields, each representing the receptive field of a difference of a single cell. So what do you see? You see lots more cells devoted to representation of the segments, this and this. That's what each of those stars represent. Okay? Compared to proximal segments, where you see sort of nondescript, larger receptive fields that aren't very specified. So you're developing the sensitivity, and you're developing increased number of cells. So what's really interesting here, that I wanted you to capture here, is that the receptive, as you develop expertise and sensitivity of a system, your receptive field size, the discrimination of that cell, gets smaller usually. But the cortical magnification actually goes up. So you end up with more cells, but they have smaller, more specificity. They become less liberal in what they care about, more detailed, but you end up with more of them. You have more area, but tighter receptive fields. Okay, I'm going to give you some better examples as we go here. And so that was an example of a hand and the haptic system. But if we go to the auditory cortex, I'm going to show you some of my favorites, just to get an idea of how malleable this is. So this is a paper by Dan Pulley, a friend of mine, and what he's done that I think is key is he's shown how task-specific, you know, your brain is in how it reorganizes and changes what it cares about. So here we have different systems. We have one group that's been trained to care about I'm talking about animal research because that's what we have to talk about to understand some of these things, and I apologize if it's, but one group only gets fed if it identifies a sound, the frequency of the sound, okay? The other group only gets fed if it identifies the level, okay? So you train one case to be level specific and care about the intensity, and the other, and frequency non-specific, and frequency specific, level non-specific, okay? So if we look at the recordings, this is what they've done then, is they've trained the system to care about 4 kilohertz, and in this case, they've trained the system to care about 40 dB. And what they're showing here is, so here, blue represents cells that care about 1 kilohertz, red represents cells that care about 32 kilohertz, okay, so we have this tonotopic representation that, you know, I said preserves sort of the cochlea. Again, these aren't humans. That's why we can go up to 32 kilohertz. These are, I think, another species, probably a mouse. And we can see the representation in the brain. Okay, this is what you would expect. This is a control, normal. This has just been free eating. Now I have a system where I have trained this animal to care about 4 kilohertz. And look, if you look at the brain, all of this region now cares about 4 kilohertz. It's become devoted to that important stimulus in my life because that means I'm going to get fed, and that's really important to me. Okay? But now when I look at loudness, it doesn't really change anything. It only cares about frequency. But now if I look at this animal where I instead care about intensity, and I look at the control for frequency recognition, I don't really see much map at all. But what I see instead is most of these cells now care about that particular intensity of the sound. Okay? Same stimulus set, just I'm not changing what I play, any of the systems. We're all experiencing the same world. What I'm changing is what it means to me. Okay? And that's really important because that is something that we all have our own view of. We all have our own world. We know what, when somebody says they experience something different from you, or they are motivated to do something, or maybe it's a student you have or something, and they're passionate about something, the impact that can have on their brain is so substantial. And you have to always remember that. It's not. It really is a physiological level that you can end up with these changes. So I have just a couple more before we finish here, but this is an example of, you know, we've talked about, I just showed you the influence of context, but this is an example of where, if I remove the input, this is anatomy, and I'm just trying to point out a couple of things. So this is a blind rat and a sighted rat, and what they've done is they've done a particular stain. So after the animal has passed away, they've done a stain where they can tell whether the neuron responded to sound or image, okay? And this is looking in V1 is the visual cortex, AC is auditory cortex. So what for a sighted rat, we would, and they're playing, this is whether it, what we're looking at specifically is the number of cells that responded to sound, in any of these areas. So if we look in V1 for a sighted rat, we don't see a lot of cells that responded to sound, which is what you would predict. But if you look in auditory cortex, you do. Okay? You just look at the number of dots here. But if we look for a blind rat, you know, congenitally blind rat, you can see that all of the visual cortex is now responding to sound. Okay? And this is something you do see. Your brain reassimilates. It makes the optimizes the capacity it has and tries to optimize sensitivities and structure so that it can do what it needs to do. Here's an example that I really think is maybe relevant to quite a few people. How many people have tinnitus? Okay, well, we all do sometimes, maybe when you also hear ringing after you've been to a loud concert or something. Significantly, there have not been really any good pathological ways of attenuating this pathological condition that have been successful. Okay, and this is Mike Kilgard, and one of his graduate students did something I thought was very clever. So tinnitus is often caused by a multitude of different things that can go wrong in the physiological system at many different levels of the pathway. Okay, and here what he was able to recognize was, rather than trying to fix one particular area, I'm going to modify the output. I'm going to change that output. And he realized that this is a naive rat, okay? What you can see, what you want to look at is simply the patterns. Okay? Imagine this is high frequency, low frequency, and you can see different representations, frequency representations to these different sounds. Now, this is a rat that's been exposed to noise. Okay? Tinnitus usually develops after noise exposure, after you have damaged your system. Okay? And what do you see? You see a loss of inhibition. You see sort of less discrimination in the system. Does everyone agree? It seems to get wider. Now, what he realized, he's like, well, rather than trying to fix the system, because we don't know where exactly the problems happen, let's use plasticity. Let's train the system and try to bootstrap the system to increase its sensitivity so that its map looks like this again. So he did that, and this system now with training, with plasticity training, and he used something called vagal nerve stimulation. Vagal nerves, and the reason he used that is because it's a vagal, your vagal nerve, you can stimulate it, and it actually sort of bootstraps the acetylcholine the cholinergic pathways and the muscarinic receptors so that you can have increased plasticity. And he saw that, and then what's beautiful is then he saw behavioral output that corresponded to the tinnitus abating, so an attenuation of the symptom of tinnitus. So this was with vagal nerve pairing, okay? You actually saw the tinnitus go away, whereas when they gave them sham therapy, and they didn't stimulate the vagal nerve, but they still had them do the same tasks, they continued to show the effect. So this is a way of assessing whether an animal has tinnitus, which is they use sort of a startle reflex, so they might be playing a tone, and the animal, they can identify where they have the tinnitus based on whether they startle to the presence of a tone, where if they're actually hearing the tone in their brain, like they're having this experience of it, they won't startle because they're hearing the tone that produces the tinnitus. So we assume if they startle, they aren't having tinnitus. Okay? All right. Is everyone okay for just a few more minutes, or are we good? All right, so we're getting there. But the main mechanisms of learning can include multiple things, and I just sort of, I'm very quickly go through these mechanistic changes in neural parameters. It can mean changes in thresholds, changes in constants. So when you have plasticity, it can mean you're more sensitive, it can mean you respond faster. It's not always just that you're more sensitive, it may just be how capable you are at responding to something. It can physiologically mean creation of new synapses, it can also mean elimination of synapses. It can mean changes in the weights and strengths. I think people have maybe heard of Hebbian learning or Hebb's postulate. It's one aspect of describing plasticity. So if you think about, here's your neuron and your action, your synapses. There's also spike timing dependent plasticity, dependent on Hebb's. In a very simple way, it's things that fire together, wire together. And I just a small anecdote. Apparently, if you write scientists when you're coming through customs in Heathrow, they actually ask you what kind of scientist you are. And I said, I'm a neuroscientist. And then he immediately asked me, I had to describe the role of acetylcholine in the brain, and I had to also describe what an action potential was. Anyhow, just I had no idea that they were gonna they were gonna ask me to give a talk, but I was prepared. No. Yeah. Then they were very confused why Dolby had hired me at all. But in any case, I had a friend who was an opera singer was actually asked to sing at the customs, so that maybe is even a little more extreme. So the basic idea is that you get a strengthening of the synaptic connection, and that can do many things, but if you think about this, it can mean long-term potentiation is something that was identified predominantly by Eric Kandel, and he won the Nobel Prize for identifying this. This is one of the things, but you know, you can end up with repeated stimulation. Some of the things that happen is you can have more neurotransmitter, so if these little circles, this is 1 week later after you've had a stimulus that's continuously been paired with another stimulus, you can end up with more neurotransmitter. You can also end up with more vesicles. So you can increase the sort of amount of neurotransmitter. You can also make it more efficient. And so this kind of thing is happening all the time, and it's allowing you to respond faster, to develop cells that are have stronger responses together. Now, certain species will be different and have very evolutionary driven pressure can change the brains, okay? If you think about what matters to me is so, we've talked about it matters to me is different than what matters to Graham, but if, what matters to me is very different than what matters to my kitty cat and to that little mouse. This is a beautiful example of some species that have really modified how they behave. This is work by Eric Knudsen, which honestly is what made me want to become a neuroscientist and study sound. This is an owl. He looks pretty cool here. But what Eric Knudsen did, and now remember, I go back to the question I posed to you about 10 minutes ago, which is what happened? Think about if I can move my eyes in my socket versus if I can't, I'm going to have a very different experience of the world. Well, owls can't move their eyes in their socket. So what's one thing that you might predict they would have that a mammal would not? Very good hearing resolution, absolutely. They have extremely good hearing resolution, like 1 millisecond. They actually, their ears are slightly asymmetrical, which gives them ITDs and ILDs and very acute. They also have a hardwired map of auditory and visual space, which doesn't make sense if you're a mammal. It's not very, because we need stationarity. I need to be able to move my eyes and not have the sound move. I need to be able to register, and I need a map of my, that's getting my ocular response and knows where my eyes are pointing and can orient, integrate all of that information. But for the owl, we actually, because they have this hardwired map, they're a really interesting system to study to understand sensory integration and plasticity. Okay? So Eric Knudsen had identified in owls many years ago that they had this, they had a map in their superior colliculus where a particular point in visual space oriented perfectly aligned with an ITD-ILD map for auditory space. Okay, and you had cells that optimally responded to that particular point and other cells that optimally responded to that particular point. We're talking about receptive fields, okay? Now, what he did was he's like, because of that, he wanted to study learning and plasticity. So he reared these owls with prism glasses on. So they grew up with their visual input always being 15 degrees off. And then he forced them to hunt. Yeah, so they grew up looking kind of cool, but they have to still have to hunt, so they have pressure on their systems to have to solve that problem. Now, what he found that was, so if here we have auditory, here's a cell, and it has an auditory and visual receptive field. I'm shifting my visual receptive field. He found the auditory receptive field followed. So he had plasticity, wanted to realign. It's really beautiful work. So if you imagine, so this is my superior colliculus, and the optic tectum, sorry, the buzz part of the superior colliculus. So the main thing you want to see in this picture is you've got input coming from the system and you've got feedback coming, but here are the key things. You can see this is the auditory input, it's realigning, recalibrating, okay? It's modifying, but if we look at the behavioral output, that's what's really nice. So he'd also looked at adults, because just because we're older doesn't mean our brains aren't still plastic. They are. It just means that you have to maybe push it a little harder. But there's absolutely, you know, no question your brains are still plastic. But here, so eyes open, and then this is the age of where the prism glasses were put on and reared. So what you can see is obviously this is where they had to start flight and sexual maturity. So for younger owls, this is the best ITD relative. So this is how much change they showed relative to the visual offset. Obviously, when they're very young and reared that way, their brain completely remaps. For adults, it also remaps, just maybe not as substantially. Okay, but it does happen. At some age, he did not get much remapping. This was for a much older owl. And you can see sort of prism-reared adult, a normal adult. So you're still getting a fairly big change. Here's, you know, the young juveniles. Obviously, there is a very, you're in a critical period. And for different types of plasticity, there are many different critical periods. But you're getting this nice critical period where the auditory and visual space map is very flexible. For an adult, it's still flexible. It's just, you know, it takes more training, more pressure on the system to make that change. And, you know, it talked about cortical magnification, you know, for an owl. I mean, sorry, I talked about owls, bats. Bats produce calls that are, you know, woo, woo, only up in ultrasound. And it's a call that has both two parts. It has a part that's a constant frequency and a part that's FM, okay? So two parts, what do they do? Constant frequency, guess? Yes, right on. And FM? What? It's really fast. It's like a broad spectrum. They're doing, it's like an impulse response, basically, is what they're trying to capture from it.
Sure.
Yep.
Sure.
Exactly. So their brain has evolved then to monitor each part of this call in a very different way, so that they're using the constant frequency. You have cortical magnification of an area that's very sensitive to the second harmonic of their call, and it's so that they can modulate. So they modulate their call when they're making calls. They modulate their call so the second harmonic is always coming back in the same frequency range. So then they care about the modulation that they've had to make to identify it. Rather than just monitoring where the call comes back, they're actually changing their call so it comes back, and they can optimize the cell sensitivity to be in a particular frequency range so they can monitor the Doppler. And similarly, then they have particular cells whose receptive fields care about the FM and are FM specific. So that's an example of an animal that needs to find dinner, and this is an example of an animal that needs to avoid being dinner. So a praying, you know, the praying mantis has evolved to be sensitive to ultrasound. You know, similarly, crickets, predatory, you know, bats are their predators. Crickets have cells that have two best frequencies on a single cell, one to about 6 kilohertz and one to about 40 kilohertz. Okay, so when this 6 kilohertz is the sound of the other crickets, and 40 kilohertz is the sound of echolocating bat. And, you know, the cricket hears 6 kilohertz, it runs towards the speaker. The cricket hears 40 kilohertz, it runs away. Very, very predictable responses. But similarly, mantis, you know, these animals, I call them animals as an insect, but sorry. But these species are really interesting because they're system has evolved to be so optimized for what's hunting it and to survive. So that if you're a species that's predated on by a bat, okay, what would you do when that gets close to you? If you're typically out in nature, what would be a good thing to do when there's an echolocating species near you? No, because I'm sending out if I'm up on a wall, and the bat sends out a impulse response, it's going to find me, right? But if I'm in a field, what should I do?
Send back
Well, that would be great. Some species might do that. Well, I should drop to the ground, though. What if I'm in a field of wheat and I drop to that ground? Suddenly, it's a big mess of signal for that echolocating animal. So that's exactly what they do. When their neurons saturate, they actually will drop, make a dive, a random dive to the ground. And I have so here you can actually see this is a bat predating on, this is a praying mantis, and you can see it make the spiral when the bat gets really close, and we can actually, I think, watch it in a second. So it just made it spiral down to the ground. So that's sort of a hardwired. This is a whole field of ethno, All right. So last thing that I'm, before I leave you, what do we do with this? How does thinking about plasticity? How can we, what are some things we can do in the future to think about it? Well, one thing I'm doing, I'm curious. How many people watched the video that was in the invite of my class? I noticed it was there. A couple people. Yeah. Okay. Good. Because I wasn't sure. I can give you an idea of just some of the things. So, Mike Mrzenich has anyone heard of Mike Mrzenich before? So Mike Mrzenich was a seminal neurophysiologist for the auditory system. He was sort of one of the first person to identify the tonotopic organization of the auditory cortex in a cat, and that was pretty critical. He's also done work that is probably some of the most seminal work for why cochlear implants exist. Understanding the tonotopy in the physiological system is a very key thing to being able to build a system like a cochlear implant and understand that that's going to actually be successful. One of the things, he's very interested in plasticity. Many of his students have studied that. He identified something that I think is among other things quite brilliant. Aside from his physiological work, he noticed that population of people classified as dyslexic were, if looking at dyslexic population classified as dyslexic and those not classified as dyslexic, which dyslexia is a multidimensional condition, okay? And it's really one that's not necessarily good or bad, but it makes it hard to do some things that you might need to do in today's culture. In another culture, I think the way you integrate information is different, and that's what I'm going to tell you, which can help in arts and help in many places. But if you want to read, it can be a big pain in the neck sometimes. So he noticed something. Here's this multidimensional condition. He noticed that they had a difference on a very simple auditory task. How many people have heard of pre and post masking? Used in codecs all the time. Okay, so that's the ability that the time that you can have a sound, a noise, and then a tone, and that noise is going to actually influence the detectability of that tone, even though it happens temporally later in time. Okay? Well, normal listener, imagine we have a gap with a constant about this. This is about right. Dyslexic patient needs a gap dyslexic classification needs a gap much longer. Okay? The noise is still influencing that. So to release that tone from the influence, what does that tell? It told him that underlying this multidimensional, condition is a temporal processing disorder. Something very simple that can affect reading and writing potentially. My ability, there's an issue to, it takes the temporal system is behaving differently. So what if we train the system to get better at gap detection? Simple auditory task and just really hammer it over and over with that plasticity in mind. We want to increase timing, increase sensitivity, change the physiological detectability of this tone. He did that, and what he found was that people got better. Their reading and writing skills increased. Okay, he now owns his vineyard and went public with his company called Scientific Learning, and in many, many elementary schools, you will find this strategy. But how do you make people do things in the amount of time you need to actually control a system? Because it takes a lot. You can't just do it. You have to get, moreover, you have to get rid of confounds. You have to make sure they're not solving the problem in other ways. You have to make sure they do it in just the way that you need them to. So gaming, he created games. And because that can be something you can control. So one thing I've been, and I think it's quite a beautiful thing. So things we've been thinking about, I've been thinking about is how do you take, sorry, I love this picture, it's really funny, but how do you take information and what is your targeted output? You know, at Stanford, one of the classes I teach is, it's called neuroplasticity and musical gaming, because and I get game developers from great game developers from computer science. I get people that, but they have to use sound in their game, but they also have to build really good games, and they do. But it's all aimed at targeting different systems, because when you take a system and you think about it, we can have all this technology, and we can, you know, the capabilities of technology are amazing, but you know, hopefully from today's lecture, you realize that that's only the first step. It's what the system does with that technology that is really where we have a lot of, also have a lot of capability and power to modify that. So let me just really quick example. This is work by some researchers in Geneva, where they took people who had never played games, and put them in, made them play first-person shooter games for 50 hours, okay? And they measured something as low level as their visual acuity to luminance gradients. Okay, this is something very, very low level that you would not expect to see change, because it's in sensitivity. And they watched this, and they just measured their detectability to see a luminance gradient. And they would be measuring the amplitude of how great this change is that it took for them to be able to just detect it. Okay, and what they saw is, so here's the control group, and here's the group after. Low is good. Low means they're more sensitive. Their threshold is lower. Okay, playing 50 hours of video games completely altered their visual acuity. Okay, this group then didn't play games for about a year, came back, and still had the change in sensitivity, still had that increase in visual acuity. Okay. So when someone says to you, you know, I want to be able to hear better, how can I hear better? You can hear better. You can change your senses. You can make yourself an expert in many different ways. So this is, you know, this is my class, but I've had students work on many different things. I've had them increase their spatial target discrimination for localization accuracy. They've built games that really train them to be able to identify fine differences in binaural sensitivity. I've had people think about the idea of, that I love this one, I thought it was very simple. They measured people's, there's always a psychophysical pre and post task, and they have to understand psychophysics, they have to understand neurophysiology, they have to target their circuit. But we talked about auditory visual integration. Well, one place where they thought it breaks down is, I go into a noisy environment and I can't hear as well as I get older. I'm weighting my auditory component too much. I should get better at I should reweight in noisy environments my visual component. So they had they measured people's speech and noise thresholds, then they trained them on lip reading until they got very good at lip reading, and then remeasured their auditory thresholds and found that in noise, and they got much better. Their speech and noise thresholds got much better for being able to understand speech when they were watching someone. Yes?
Why is that? Because when you're older, your response curve decreases on the extremes, lower number?
Well, it's so there are multiple reasons for why. I mean, you have presbycusis, so you have high frequency loss, and that's important in understanding the transients in a noisy environment. Those fine transients are critical to being able to track speech. You also have often a temporal slowing as you age, and that can affect speech. We also know that where you may have normal audiograms, we're now finding that certain cells responsible for sort of higher level sounds can actually be damaged, because you have different, imagine you have, so I have cells that care about different dynamic ranges. So if I damage, say, the class that cares about high, you know, dynamic range from like 60 dB to 100 dB, but the other cells are intact, I'm gonna have different deficits. So there are a lot of things that can go wrong. In any case, this is something that can happen. I've had people want to train, phonemic differences that are lost in a particular language from, you know, wanting to study language learning. I've had, you know, people want to learn how to hip-hop dance better, or wanted to train people to be able to play piano. I've had concert pianists who come and take the class and then want to build what they think is going to be a sort of neuroplasticity-targeted learning to, you know, hearing that focuses on certain things. So anyhow, it's a lot of fun. So finally, my last question to you is this. If we're going to take this information and build augmented sensory devices, can we create new technologies that allow sensory capabilities behind those that we've evolved naturally? How many people think we can? Yes, absolutely we can. We already are. We're doing that. But how can we best modify our brains to optimally make use and harness this potential and really change the way we experience the world around us? Because it's optimizing our brain. You know, we can optimize our brains, but we also have to take advantage of this technology and do with it what we can. And, you know, more is not better. It's doing the right thing, because that's what, you know, there's a reason why our brains have evolved the way they have. All right, and so then I will leave you with that. But if you stare at this for just a little while, I promise you, I'll give you, you'll see the last thing. All right, so before I switch to the next one, just you can stare at that. Are there any questions, sir? So, yes.
Yeah, at the beginning with the auditory illusions and visual illusions, is there much work on how long it takes your brain to adapt and work out that it's an illusion? Because a lot of the visual ones, I know that you can know it's the same, like the size of the two monsters.
Right.
And you can look at that 100 times and you still think they're different when they go back, even though you know they're not. But you say your brain's not learning that it's actually the same, if you see what I mean. They still see the visual illusion. As opposed to learning that it isn't an illusion.
Right, so there are some that are sort of more hardwired based on, or there are certain expectations. I mean, some are really hard to override, and some can happen more easily. Looking at the time, I think different illusions are going to have different time constants. In some cases, it's not just going to be time, it might be distance. It might be, in that case, I'd say it's the opacity. So it's the thing that we can modulate is we can modulate the influence of knowing that cylinder is casting a shadow. But once that cylinder's there and casting a shadow, it's pretty hard to override that, because that's something that's really hardwired into our physiological system. But like something like ventriloquism, I know features that are going to modulate how strong an auditory and visual cue bind are going to be: distance, proximity. It's going to be temporal coherence, you know, and it's going to be, those are two very big, you know, as something's more coherent, and the auditory and visual are modulating in time similarly, they're going to bind stronger. And as we manipulate that, it's going to be easier to override, similarly with space. But it's really hard. You can train your system. Here's a good example, I think, that will speak more to what you're trying to say. How many people have heard of the precedence effect? Great. You know, when we walk in an environment that's echoic, there's the direct sound, plus there's many reflections coming off the walls. We don't identify the location of me or as of the source, the primary source, from coming from the walls or where the reflections are. Instead, we suppress those in terms of the location information. Now, what about a blind subject, for example? Blind subjects can develop more acuity, find tighter acuity to hearing those reflections than a sighted subject. I mean, because they are developing a sensitivity that their system needs or is making use of. So in some ways, that's overriding what would be the natural state to experience that illusion, right? In a way that is quite low level and fundamental. So if you're looking at this, then how many people see this as black and white, or how many people see colored hues?
Black and white.
You still see black and white?
You
do. So if you do this right and you stare at it a while, it will last for a long time. It's called the McCulloch effect, but yes, Grant.
Just a comment on what you said about sighted people and sighted. We know that, for example, I'm boring here, organists, the blind organists, have this incredible ability to walk up to something with massive amount of knobs and get it.
Yes.
Very quickly, and then do a concert very quickly, and then move on the next day somewhere else. And they obviously have a very enhanced spatial awareness. There's a map somewhere that they can do. And the other thing is a question. There's an implication in what you said towards the end, that, for example, I'm aware with age that my gray perception is not as good, the contrast.
Mm-hmm.
It was very interesting to hear that can be taught. Is there an implication here that something that may have gone wrong with the body due to aging can be relearned, that there's an ability, making idea of the frequency map, the fact that you could get your hearing, not rejuvenated necessarily, but back in a better way, and that you could train your eyes to do a better job with what they have.
Yes.
Is that?
Yes.
I won't.
So there are three different things I'll say. I will say, can you do better than? Can you take advantage of this to, gain things that will allow you to be more sort of do better than you would otherwise? Yes. So even something as simple as I showed you I won't call it simple, but the tinnitus is an example. I have tinnitus. I can, they're actually that was a wrap, but they're actually doing this therapy on humans. Right, that's an example of remapping so that I have a different experience than I would have that is going to allow me to be better. Similarly, you can do this with different modalities for different functions. But if my input going in, so if all my hair cells are dead and I've damaged my hair cells, say at above 6 kilohertz, I can't, without stimulation, from a cochlear implant or something, I have no input. The input can't get there. I can't do anything with it. Now, could we use training to make the input from a cochlear implant more pleasurable? I mean, because the music does not sound good on cochlear implants. Could we make it more useful, more, work with the system better? Absolutely. But you have to have an input, and you're only as good as what your input is to be able to work with that system. So that's one. Two then is where I started to go with cochlear implants is what can we do with devices to provide? So if I have, a hearing loss at 8 kilohertz, but I say I haven't lost my inner hair cells, I've only lost my outer hair cells. So I can modify so that with amplitude increase, I can, with gain increase, I can still hear. It's not that there's nothing getting through the system. Then I can use technologies and plasticity to create a system that's going to be much, much more efficient, and I can create systems where I can hear and see potentially things I didn't see before. Maybe I'm mapping them into domains. I'm taking information that exists and remapping it into domains that my physiological system can work with. What I could do is increase sensitivity. There's no question that all of us have different sensitivities that maybe our neighbor sitting next to us doesn't have. And they have different sensitivities that we don't have. And so those are all things that we can imagine being malleable to. So is that... Yeah.
Before we take the floor any further, just two things. Firstly, could we use a microphone just for the benefit of the recording? And secondly, it's now 8:30, so if anyone has to get out of London for any reason to eat their way through a bowl of lemons or something, please go whenever you need to. You're not being rude. So can we continue the questions? Thanks.
Any color yet? I don't know.
Just picking up on a couple of things you've mentioned tonight. So you were talking about codecs earlier and, uh-huh. and the reliance of sort of neurological processes in order to develop codecs. But then we've also talked about plasticity. And so is there not a kind of paradox in there that by studying the present neural mechanism in order to develop the codec, are we then... Does the brain then not develop through plasticity to be able to hear the artifacts subsequently that one couldn't at the beginning? Does that arms race kind of situation between the codec and the plasticity of the brain?
That's a really good. If you go and you look at, we deal with this a lot in how you assess the efficacy of a codec too, which is if you look at any of the ITUR specifications for BS1116 or 1534, which are what are used sort of for codec shootouts and things like that, they're only to be done by expert listeners.
Yeah.
So those expert listeners do not hear if you take the thing you see for a naive listener, if you have them listen to different bitrate trade-offs, is they grade everything pretty high, right? Experts learn to hear the artifacts, and it is a matter of plasticity. One of my students, that's exactly what they did, was try to work on training the ability to hear artifacts in different coding algorithms, because that's what they cared about. But yes, I mean, so you want to have the most discriminating listeners be the ones that are defining what good and best are in many ways, right? Because
their experience with what they've had in the past, so that I guess just it's exposure time to the present codecs.
I mean, it's an example of, so if we look at coding artifacts for, say, 5.1 or stereo, Those are really different, and this is something I brought up multiple times. In the near future, there's sort of a transition to advanced sound codecs with, you know, I don't know, object-based codecs or many channels, 13.1, 22.2, or whatever. The types of artifacts that show up in these systems are very different than what have come in stereo or 5.1. And so who are the experts? What have they been trained in? What are they listening for? It can't be the same. You have to define what the artifacts are, and then you have to you have to train the brain and train your experts to be experts to make sure you have the most discriminating people listening to that content, right? Because I agree 100%. You want your experts being the ones that say what is good enough, because then, you know, the rest of us will hear it fine.
Anybody else?
Just very quickly, where will we get more information about the musical gaming and the work you're doing?
Oh,
I think you put something up, but it went by quick.
Yeah, here, if you have a brief moment, I can do this really quickly, which, let's see. This takes just a second if you want to, let me see. Here, this is.
I'm Poppy Crum. I'm a senior scientist at Dolby Laboratory, and I'm also a consulting professor.
This is just one class. Stanford. They built these in about a couple of weeks. They're games, but
we're here today because you are at the Sonic Synapse Arcade. It's the open house for a course I teach in neuroplasticity and musical gaming. It's the synthesis of how we take what we know about the brain and what we know about neuroscience and try to leverage that into something that people can use, something that is actually create a product, create a game, create an environment that we can make it fun to train our brains, to learn new skills, to increase our cognitive capacity, to teach us how to sing music, to teach us how to dance better.
So our game is Overtone, and it is a game for pitch training.
These
so
are college freshmen. The freshmen.
In a noisy environment where multiple tones are being played, to isolate the pitch of a single tone in that mess of kind of tones.
It's a scene analysis
that
they were
in
trying
your
to train.
Long enough to be able to reproduce it through singing. The game works as follows. So you're presented with kind of a simple graphical interface like this, where there are currently, at the start, there are no links between the nodes. You're presented with kind of a series of tones through the headphones that are played kind of asynchronously and overlapping on each other, making it difficult to distinguish the pitch of each given tone. And so what happens is, as you kind of start to focus in on each of the tones and kind of identify the pitch and mentalize the pitch, internalize it, you start to sing. And as you start to sing, and if you kind of can match the pitch of one of these tones, beam will emanate from one of these nodes and start to connect with the other target node. The name of our game is Bubbles, and the motivation behind the game is that across the world, English has become the global language. It's used not just to connect native speakers with each other, native speakers with non-native speakers, but also to connect non-native speakers with each other. So there's a lot of variation across accents in the world, and because the phonological rules are different in these different accents, it can present difficulties when speakers of different accents talk to each other. Our ultimate hope is, like, if we can teach people to hear sound contrasts like this in other accents of English, we can help people all across the world who are speaking English to each other understand each other better. What we wanted to do was create a game that would help people localize sounds in their environment. So basically, we wanted to use binaural cues to train people to correctly identify the angle and elevation of sounds coming at them. So we created a game in which you control a gun, basically, and you hear incoming enemies coming from different directions, and you point where you think the enemy's coming from, and you fire. And you get a feedback whether you hit or miss the enemy.
The way we tested whether our subjects were improving at the task was with just a very simple task in which we had spatialized sounds that you played over headphones, and then you click on the screen, just basically saying wherever you perceive the sound.
They were using a Leap controller. They were really interested in using spatial controllers that they could interact with.
Put somebody in an environment that they just want to spend hours playing and hours working at it. You have the potential and the possibility to take that to another level and to actually really change things.
yeah, ignore me, but they were pretty. So, yeah, all right, thank you. So I, yeah, that's an example. I can point you in directions of different.
Crumb.
Sorry, oh, we don't want to do this again. Sorry. Okay. Sorry. But it's a lot of fun to see what direction people go and the different types of students you get. They've made some very interesting games that have been quite advanced. So.
No more questions? Oh, I think you must have been extraordinarily comprehensive. I'd like to thank you very much for an extraordinarily compelling lecture.
Oh.
One of the longest ones, but also one of the more engaging as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for hanging out with me.